internet, and she got very famous. She has now a lot of new friends and a lot of new enemies. So, Anna.
Okay, thank you, Sebastian. And yeah, so I would like to thank Ute, and it's great fun to be here at this meeting. I consider this topic, politicization of science, to be most important topic that we can consider today. It's more important than any possible disease or pandemics. It is more important than anything related to climate change or pollution or sustainability or energy crisis, because by politicizing science, we undermine it and we undermine our ability to solve these real challenges that humanity faces. What I mean by politicization of science is invasion of ideology. And this ideology was described today by people who understand its philosophical origins much better than I do. It goes by the name of wokeism or by the name of critical social justice. And for those, for chemists in the audience, don't get fooled by the words, because there is nothing critical about this theory. And it has as much to do with social justice as Orwellian Ministry of Love had to do with love. So I decided to talk about what I know, and I know chemistry and how chemistry is done. And I decided to focus on just one example, focus on scientific publishing and illustrate how this ideology subverts it. All right, I will start with a story, old story in 17th century. And it is about Antony van Leeuwenhoek. He was a Dutchman. He started his life as the cloth merchant, as a draper, and he had a hobby. He liked to play with glass, and he managed to create, improve glass polishing techniques and other techniques, and create what we call today a microscope, a magnifying device. And through that, he was able to discover many new things. He was able to see how blood goes through the vessels. He was able to see microorganisms and so on. So today we think of Leeuwenhoek as the father of microbiology. Now, what is very important is Leeuwenhoek did not keep his observations to himself. He would write them in the letters, describe and document by drawings, and send them to the philosophical transactions of the Royal Society, to the chairman or president of the Royal Society. And he published about 190 of these transactions, publications. Here is an example of first published image obtained using microscope that documents this intricate anatomy details of bees. Leeuwenhoek also was the first to observe sperm. Here is a drawing that shows sperm from rabbits and dogs, and that was a real breakthrough in understanding sexual reproduction. What is interesting is that Leeuwenhoek was very hesitant sending this report to the Royal Society, and he preceded his letter with the following. He said, "If your lordship should consider that these observations may disgust or scandalize the learned, I earnestly beg your lordship to regard them as private and to publish or destroy them as your lordship sees fit." Now, luckily for humanity, his lordship didn't think much about offending people, published this report as is, and it was very important breakthrough. Well, things could have turned to Leeuwenhoek very differently in 2021. As an editor of a journal for Royal Society of Chemistry, I received, along with other editors, a memoranda that instructed us that editors must consider whether or not any content might have the potential to cause offense. They clarified the aim of this guidance is to help you to identify and prevent the publication of inappropriate content in our journals and books. So they go at great length to explain that intent doesn't matter. they say that it can be a disparity between the intention of an author and how their content might be perceived. And they stated clearly, it is the perception of the recipient that determines offense, regardless of the author intent. Now, the document gives us plenty of indicators to provide guidance what can be offensive. There were like 15 of them, but I think just two of the listed indicators would have sufficed, or even one. So the last indicator is content that likely to be upsetting, insulting, or objectionable to some or most people. That's enough. You can censor anything in chemistry and beyond. Yeah. So, well, one may think, and I heard such a comment that, okay, it's just words, they do not mean it. It's not relevant for chemistry, you know, what can be offensive? Of course, if you work in life sciences and involved in a contentious research, stem cells, or differences between sexes or sexual reproduction, okay, maybe, but in chemistry, who cares? Well, turns out, you know, it's not that simple, and chemistry can be a minefield of offensive language and offensive concepts. According to critical social justice ideologues, the very plain language, English language, can be very offensive, and it contains number of words and phrases in technical language, in everyday word, that are offensive, and according to this ideology, they are responsible on reinforcing power structures, oppression, discrimination, patriarchy, and all horrible things. So here are some examples from various documents, quantum supremacy, technical term that refers to the transformative potential of quantum computing is not to be used because it uses a supremacy in it. Divide and conquer algorithms, master database, dummy variable, black and white thinking, black market, disabled account, grandfathered accounts, all the software, sanity check, blind spot, tarball, archive file. So these are all forbidden language. You cannot say strawman argument or simply, hi guys. Motherboard is forbidden, picnic, long time no see. Now, according to Google Guides, smartphones is not a recommended term. It's offensive to other phones. And the normal is problematic. If you look for a soap from Dove, you will not find a soap for normal skin because it's a very divisive concept. So now. You have to be very knowledgeable to see these connections, and yeah, well, that's why we need this giant bureaucracies, the AI bureaucracies that compile these lists of words and explain why they are. So,
sorry, I thought, what about the matter in science?
Yes. Well, many of these bureaucracies that compile these lists of words, they have web forms in which you can submit a proposal for an offensive word. So you can submit it and they will consider and add it to the list. So this is encouraged. So virtually any major institution or company such as Google, Microsoft are engaging in this Orwellian war on language. This is a satirical depiction from a dissident website, Bubbling Beaver at MIT. So I think this is cut a little bit that shows this MIT Associate Dean of Inquisition today announced the publication of volume 12 of the Index of Forbidden Words. Now it's a satire, but it's not that far from reality. All right, so words are more about language. Since I decided to talk about publishing, I decided to look at concrete examples. And by now, American Chemical Society, which one of the major publishers in chemistry, publishes more than 100 titles, has this giant document that shows examples of non-inclusive language and proposes alternatives and some explanations. It's complete with references, with theoretical background. You can also download exercise worksheets and practice to see if you mastered it. And here are some examples. You cannot say people affected by obesity. You should say people do not prescribe to your larger patients what would be diagnosed. Da, 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 da. Now, it goes beyond replacing words. They also forbid concepts, even though it's a style guide. So you cannot say obesity is a public health crisis. What they recommend to say instead is that anti-fat bias and discrimination are public health crises. Not the same, right? It's not just replacing the word. So more examples, you're not supposed to say suffer from cancer. You cannot say double-blind, randomized controlled trials. So, well, they often. So you cannot say anymore he or she if you do not know gender of a person you're talking about, because they say there is more than two genders, and this is not. So this is a good one. You are not allowed to say an employee who is a nursing mother. That's not an inclusive term. You're supposed to use the following language. You will accommodate an employee who wants to express milk for their child. So boring and lame is not to be said. You cannot say cast a dark cloud over the meeting or dark times. This is also not inclusive and not recommended. So there is actually now a software that can help to improve your style and ferret offensive language. Microsoft Word has a plugin that can give you suggestions of how to write more inclusively. Google and Microsoft, they have softwares that will check your code, computer code, and see if there is something offensive, you know, if you have lines that have to connect to master database. Yeah, and they can, you know, they have tools to rewrite it automatically around it and so on. So, okay, it's language, but this activities do not stop at language guide, and there are also offensive names and offensive people. Here are some examples of famous people that contributed to different areas of sciences. William Shockley, Fritz Haber, his name was mentioned today, Erwin Schrödinger, and so on. And what unites people listed here is that these names were under critique recently, and they are at different stages of cancellations. Some names are removed from school programs, some are removed from awards, and yeah, Newton, the name of Newton is removed from many schools, and some American schools do not recommend to use Newton laws, but ask to say three great laws of nature without mentioning Newton name. In two things. One is that he was white, and they want to decenter whiteness in the curriculum. And in some, in UK, I think they also point out that as being a rich man at this time, he benefited from colonialism and he had financial, no, he was well-to-do man, so he benefited from colonialism and therefore should be, no, he did not. Some people didn't have anything, so Ronald Fisher, a father of modern statistics, has been canceled because statistics can be used to justify some bad practices. So, No, I do not think it's true because, again, I would, I read a few articles in his defense written by experts in the field who know his writings, and they made the compelling argument that the claims against him were exaggerated. So more or less, you know, any old white man can be canceled just because. It's not a complete list, it's just a few examples. Now, what I wanted to emphasize is the facts do not matter. So it's not only about presentism that these people have some views that we do not approve today or did something wrong. And a good illustration of this is the cancellation of James Webb. So he was the head of NASA at NASA's, you know, glorious days when he led NASA when they sent men to the moon. And it was decided to name a space telescope after him, James Webb telescope. And that generated, again, cancellation campaign by a number of scholars, and there was a petition out blaming him for homophobic views and blaming him for discriminating against gay employees, firing him, and all kinds of bad things. Now, in a very unusual pattern, people at NASA did not fold in right away and actually did some research, engaged with historians. You know, it's not such a distant history, so it's very easy to find out who he was, what he did, and what he said. And they found no evidence of any of this. None. Absolutely none. They published a long report, 80 pages, and but that didn't stop the mob. They continue with their petition. And what is interesting is how publishers react to that. Here is an expert from Royal Astronomical Society. They cannot rename the telescope, but they can tell the authors who publish in their journal what to do. And they say that they expect that authors submitting scientific papers to their journals will use the acronym rather than the full name of the observatory. In this case, the previous requirement for the acronym to be spelled out at first mention will not be observed. So the name should not be said. Now, so do you think this, that to me is reminiscent to religious taboo type of a practice, and I do not know whether it's a hyperbolic comparison or not. Well, anyway, so at this point, you may be wondering, so, okay, so silly, doesn't make any sense. Neither the campaign on language, nor the cancellations of names of people, but it's not really so important for the practice of science. You know, what do we care what language we use as long as we can communicate a meaning? We will not lose much if we will not call Schrödinger equation, and call it wave equation. However, maybe the wave equation number 25, However, this intrusion of the ideology doesn't stop at these issues and goes much further. So it goes further to suppress ideas and viewpoints and even suppress research. So we already heard very detailed and account of the Thomas Hudlitsky affair that Uti described. So that was an example of suppression of ideas and viewpoints. I will mention this more recent example. Astronomer John Cormody attempted to publish a research paper in which he attempted to look for statistical analysis metrics that would be useful to evaluate people, future astronomers, in terms of their potential impact and professional merit, and with the motivation to make the process of hiring and promotion more fair. So he wrote a paper, submitted to PNAS, Proceedings of National Academy of Science, and put it on some preprint server. However, the idea of merit and using metrics to evaluate merit enraged many people, and there was a Twitter outrage, and he retracted the paper and published this apology. He said, I meant good. The paper was intended to decrease bias and improve fairness. It was especially intended to help us to do the best science that we can do, but intentions do not in the end matter. What matters is what my actions achieve. And I now see that my work has hurt people. I apologize, blah, 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 blah. So that's a direct suppression of research results. Now, you may think that that's an exception, an outlier, but that's not true. Well, merit is a white supremacist and colonialism and patriarchal concept. It perpetuates these evils.
So because of what like you have the FAQ, one group higher than the other group.
Yeah. Right. So the world results.
The world results.
Okay.
And what the members get the better on.
So, we can discuss it in more detail later. So, it's not an outlier. These are not an outliers. This statement of editors of Nature Human Behavior Journal was mentioned today by Andreas. Here are some quotes from this article. And what they do, they call for additional censorship of publications. They say, although academic freedom is fundamental, it is not unbounded. Okay, how is it bounded? Advancing knowledge and understanding is a fundamental public good. We all agree. In some cases, however, potential harms to the population studied may outweigh the benefit of publication. And they go on and they again repeat the same thing. They say that it's not an intent of researchers and not a content. They say research may inadvertently stigmatize individuals of human groups and so on. And they say right away that they will just not publish research that they will consider to be potentially harmful in the future to some groups. How they would know what is harmful? Well, they say they will be using their judgment and they say they will consult with ethics experts. Okay, that may be not so bad. And with advocacy group. Now, think about it. If let's say there is a research about abortion and you consult this pro-life movement, whether it should be published, or there is a research about effects of puberty blockers and sex reassignment surgeries on minors, and you consult these transgender activists and they say, well, no, it will, no, shouldn't publish. So, some go even further. Further than just censoring research from publication, but call to censor to not allow research to go forward. And there is a paper from Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences where they present a proposal. They call to establish ethics review boards that would review research proposals, not for, you know, whether you do research on animals or human subjects in an ethical manner, which is, of course, routinely done and not controversial. They will examine your proposal, whether the research may in the future cause harms to groups or populations. And if it causes harms, then you know it shouldn't be funded. So they include examples of harms. They say risks that arise due to the technology being co-opted for nefarious purposes. They talk about potential harms to any population, such as job loss due to automation or progress. Potential harms to specific subgroups, such as technical barriers to using technology that is prohibitive to poorer populations. Now that already gets pretty close to my research because you know we work on computer algorithms and they can be very easily co-opted for nefarious purposes. Our scientific models can be used to design, you know, better explosives or chemical weapons by Putin or other regimes. The things we do ultimately can lead, we hope, to new technologies. For example, if we develop good solar energy technology, it will definitely displace more traditional energy sectors and will cause job loss. So by this metrics, my research can be canceled almost entirely. So that's so far we talked about censorship. However, this critical social justice subverts publishing in a more fundamental way and goes beyond just censorship and suppression of ideas and suppression of research. And here I would like to come back. This word telos was mentioned today. It is a term that refers to an ultimate object or aim or purpose of something. So a telos of university is to seek truth and to educate. Telos of a publishing house is to facilitate publication of valid scientific research and exercise, you know, all this complicated process of peer review, waiting, expertise, and so on. However, what we see now that publishers increasingly replace this purpose by social justice purposes. Here is an example Royal Society of Chemistry posted a joint commitment for action on inclusion and diversity in publishing, where they pledged to engage all relevant stakeholders to improve outcomes on inclusion and diversity at all stages of the publishing process. So you may wonder what, you know, what these social justice causes have to do with publishing, and the connection is tenuous. Now, what is shocking is that if you look at all the publishers that signed to the statement, I couldn't find any publisher that publishes chemistry papers that is not on this list. They're all there. And that was done without consulting with the professional editors, with authors, with the community. So it just happened. So, let's look in more details what exactly do they mean, how they are going to improve outcomes for diversity. Here is a remarkable document, Framework for Action in Scientific Publishing, published again by the Royal Society of Chemistry, which is an important publisher. And they say in this document that our data show differences in the likelihood of article acceptance depending on the gender of authors, reviewers, and editors. Notably, women are disadvantaged compared to men when disseminating their research. And then they talk about what, how we can act on it. Now, I published about 300 papers in my life. I reviewed probably 1,000, I do not know, didn't count how many papers. I served as an editor, processed many papers. And in my experience, I did not experience any bias or discrimination in the process of publishing. You know, it's not to say that I haven't seen biases or barriers that women face that exist. I experienced some myself, I witnessed some, but in publishing, no, haven't seen it. But maybe I'm wrong, it's just my personal experience, and they say they have data and they have huge respect for data. So I decided I need to look at this data, because that's a very strong statement they make. So it's described in this report. The centerpiece of this report is the study solicited by the Royal Society of Chemistry, carried out by 3 computational chemists and published in a very decent journal, Chemical Science. And that's the title, is there gender gap in chemical sciences school communication? And of course, the answer is yes, of course. It's a serious paper, it's an intimidating paper. It's of course peer reviewed, has 25 pages long, has 32 figures, and based on the analyzing of more than 500,000 articles. So it is a serious, serious study. I didn't have time and expertise to fully analyze it. So I asked Jay Tanzman, who is here, a statistician, a competent statistician, to analyze and kind of provide analysis of it. And here are some points to consider. So one biggest problem of the study is that they only quantify the outcomes, the differences, and they do not even make an attempt to control for confounding factors. For example, let's imagine there is a different outcome for female and male authors to have their paper accepted. So the first thing to do would be to control for factors such as seniority, country of origin, field, and so on. Not done. There were some other technical questions, but most important one is that this paper talks a lot about statistical significance, but they do not really talk much about practical significance. So what is that? Okay, let us look at actual data and see what it is. So here is an example. It's figure 20B from the paper that shows how often editors agree with reviewers' recommendations. And it's broken by the gender of editors. Here are female editors, male editors. And here is gender of reviewer, female reviewers, male reviewers. So you see that male editors agree with reviewer recommendations regarding of their gender, more or less the same number. So these error bars, they describe statistical significance, right? What is the statistical uncertainty here. So this is a panel for female editors, and we see that they agree more often, more frequently with female reviewers than the male, and the gap is huge, right? So we see the statistical variations are much smaller than difference between two numbers, and it's very serious effect. Now, if you do not know how to interpret it, the authors guide you through the process, and they tell you. They say that this figure means that the interaction of editor gender and review gender shows that the relationship is significant. They say that female editors agree with female reviewers significantly more than male reviewers. So very serious, right? So let's look at the y-axis. So what does it mean in practice? So here are the numbers. Proportion of status and review recommendations agree. So, so that's a separate topic, which you can say that, yeah, there is a problem here. But again, you know, in order to make the statement, you need to control. Maybe female editors invite female reviewers that they know better than the male reviewers, or something like that, to be completely innocent. But anyway, so these are the numbers. So if I were to write this paper, I would say that female editors agree with female reviewers 84% and with male reviewers 82%. And male editors agree with reviewers 83.5% regardless of gender. So that's it. There is no effect. There is statistical significance, but if all our problems would be, you know, in this magnitude, we wouldn't have any problem. So going further, so this critique of this paper, we saw the data, and the rest of the data is more or less the same. So this picture is quite representative. But conclusions, nevertheless, are very tendentious. They say that at each step of publication, we see small but significant drops in the female percentage of authors, and the authors describe it as death by thousand cuts. So I think this quality of this paper is not very good, but unfortunately, nevertheless, this paper is used to justify some action. Now, even if they found significant discrepancies between male and female, the question of intervention would be a very serious one. What should be done? But here, you know, based on just mere descriptive statistics and based on the result that essentially shows that there is no discrimination against women in publishing, they come up with a number of action points, and that's the subject of this document, and then they call for things like pretty heavy social engineering. They call for quotas among editors and reviewers, and they have specific number, 36%, which probably already achieved. And this number is very interesting in itself, because if you look at demographics in chemistry, and we have these numbers, currently in chemistry, we have about 20% of women in tenure and tenure track positions. So if you call for 36% of chemistry editors be women, it means that if you're a woman, you have twice higher chance to be elected to this editorial board than a man, which is unfair to the men. And it also means that if you want 36% of the reviewers to be women, it means that if you're a woman, you have to do twice as much shit work as if you were a man. So it's not going to help women. So nevertheless, despite all this, the study is cited, and this framework for action is lauded. Here is a quote from ACS paper that says that we have seen the biases largely through the lens of gender in Western countries and applaud our colleagues at the RSC for their massive study that explored these gender barriers. So it's already barriers, right? So in the publishing pipeline and their recent inclusion and diversity framework. And then, of course, ACS goes further and says that we should do more and include race into these considerations. So more examples. I do not want to sound as I'm picking up on RSC or ACS. It's like everywhere. Here is an example from contract given me by Wiley for another journal. I refuse to sign it because this contract tells that as the editor, I should endeavor to promote diversity, equity, and inclusion in the editorial process. In particular, the editor will endeavor to ensure the best possible diversity, equity, and inclusivity in the editorial board, reviewer pool, and authorship. I said it's not what editors should do. Editor should execute peer review process to the best of your ability, and that's it. So they removed this clause from my contract, but I'm sure it lives in other editors' contract. If you go to submit a paper to Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, at the stage when you need to enter the reviewer names, you will see this recommendation plotted, and PNAS will say that PNAS believes diversity is an important factor in ensuring a balanced manuscript review. Please consider gender, race, ethnicity, and country of origin when suggesting potential reviewers. So could be, you know, like subject for 5 hours lecture. I could give you many examples. I just will mention briefly citation justice. It was described by Andreas in the morning, and these are calls to cite in your papers more minorities, more women, more people from underdeveloped world, from global source, and what's not. And there are also software tools popping out on internet. For example, some journals would recommend to run your manuscript through this free online gender balance assessment tool, which will tell you whether or not you are gender balanced. Now, how this tool can tell me, you know, how many women I should cite in a quantum chemistry paper, you know, beyond me. Now, one interesting way to, well, anyway, so I will leave it for later discussion. So others, here is an example from Elsevier, what they do and what they want to do. And you see that it's all about heavy social engineering and quotas. So I will wrap up. So just from the examples of publishing, we see how critical social justice or wokeism subverts scientific publishing and replaces its main purpose by promoting social justice, quote unquote, ideas. So the science of it is Orwellian language policing. They suppress viewpoints and research results, and there are many examples of this. And they call for censorship of valid research. And they also subvert the whole process of how editorial process and publishing works by using social justice criteria instead of merit, intellectual merit and validity in the publication process through the quotas to editors, reviewers, authors, calls to cite people by their gender and so on. So that's it. Thank you very much. And we'll be